Welcome to Fandom Night, the only show that beat the Kobayashi Maru.
I'm God damn host, right we did.
I'm your host, Reploid Bill, William Bush. Let's do the co-host thing.
We did that shit legit.
That's not a co-host thing.
No, it's up to you guys.
I figured Birthday Boy wanted to go first. Whatever.
No.
All right, fine. Seth Level, sorry.
Shane McCree, proto guy.
You saved the best for last. Come on. Nick Bennett, Lone Paladin.
Not today. Today it's Drunkenin.
No. Today it's Hungoverdin. Oh my god, my fucking head.
I'm not here.
Disembodied voice.
Yay.
No assemble.
How would you assemble a disembodied voice?
That very, actually is very a good question.
How about two?
Oh god, there's two.
Yeah, we actually installed a voice modulator on the disembodied voice. That way it just randomly changes for us now. Now with that done, you guys talk. I'm going to take a nap.
Okay, he wants to take a nap. So, we are fulfilling a promise made on the very first podcast to make good on episodes that we said we would complete. We are going over the Final Fantasy Legacy. Please run down our scores, Shanimus.
Let's talk while I find it.
Talk.
Why do we make
found it?
Promises.
Okay. We scored Final Fantasy 1 a 2.75, Final Fantasy 2 a 1.83,
Ooh.
Final Fantasy 3 1.75.
Holy that one crap. Sucked worse.
Final Fantasy 4 Complete Collection 4.57.
Because it was pimp.
Final Fantasy 4 DS. We rated it 2.37.
It sucked some nuts.
You gonna be okay?
Are you gonna make it, guys?
And we rated
Final Fantasy 5 is at a 3.23. Jesus, man, come on.
Because it was okay.
Today we are on Final Fantasy 6, and the first thing we do.
Actually, the first thing we do is we pick a version.
That's what I was going to say.
I figured you were like, the first thing we do is see it.
No.
I was like, really, guy?
No, I created the format.
Hey, it wouldn't be the first time I've had to jump in and save your ass, though.
Damn Drunkenin.
Hungoverdin.
Oh,
yeah. Hungoverdin right now.
It is different.
I don't know. Wait, we still got any beer left in the fridge. I'll go get drunk again.
So, version?
Honestly, I would love to say the iOS Android, but fuck no. We're going to go with
PlayStation
PS1.
That's the only one I played.
I have heard that the translation is better on the Game Boy Advance, but I have not personally played it myself.
Yeah.
Neither have I.
Doesn't matter.
So, that puts us on PlayStation, and the first thing we do when we turn on our game is we see the motherfucker!
It's still in its 16-bit glory!
This is a game that even today shows us that as long as you work with what you've got, you can make a damn good-looking game. This is one of those games that was built on a system that is so inferior by today's standards that... Yeah. There's no denying it. The Super Nintendo does not hold a candle to anything that we can do today. But they produced a game that was so visually appealing. Real feels, my menses. Real feels.
Shane knows all about real feels.
He knows about real feels.
Ain't that right, buddy?
Back to Final Fantasy.
Times.
No, but honestly, I've seen games that look, I can't say I've seen games that look better. Like, they might have a better character model, but the rest of it, like, everything about this game is appealing. And if you talk about see it, I guess at the same point in time, we hear it too. And this has one of the best musical scores in the entire Super Nintendo library.
Oh, yeah.
All of it. Even Mega Man.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, in fact, they even released an entire CD with the music from it.
Yeah, when they released this game for the PlayStation, they released an actual compact disc, which was the soundtrack in general.
Yep.
This...
Music Silence by Whistle.
Yeah.
I don't know what to say 100% here. I just don't, like...
Final Fantasy V, amazing to actually put into words. Bill does that. Yeah, it's kind of right, but not really.
It's hard to explain. It really
That's
is.
That's why I said it's too
when
amazing
you look
to put
at
in
it,
real words.
If I showed you a screenshot of it and told you that it looked amazing, you'd probably laugh at me. Especially if you showed it to a 12-year-old today.
Well, 12-year-olds today are a bunch of, you know, Call of Duty fags,
but,
so it doesn't matter.
But even by, like... Okay, but you could even go to Shane. Shane was not the kind of person that plays old games. He just... doesn't. It's not his thing. Like, he looks at Final Fantasy V, he looked at Final Fantasy IV, and remember what he said? He said, looks like ass. Period. No way around it.
Well, Shane
looks
is
like
just
ass.
Butthurt about 4 anyways, because Cecil becomes a paladin.
He didn't like the way it looked. He liked the way it looked on Final Fantasy IV Complete. But he told you that the DS, when they moved this thing into 3D, it looked like ass.
I even told you it looked like ass.
I'm just telling you.
I hated the chibi look.
It just, but it works better with Shane because Shane does not like old games. When you show him Ninja Gaiden, those graphics look like ass. He might like the game, but he doesn't care for the graphics. They don't hold up by today's standards, and Shane is eye candy person. He likes to turn on the game and play Final Fantasy XIII because it looks like he bought Final Fantasy XIII, Final Fantasy XIII 2, and Final Fantasy XIII.
Lightning's Return.
There you go. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm so fucking sorry.
Sorry, Shane was staring deep in my eyes.
Yeah.
So, like...
Yeah, there really is. There's only one point in the entire game where, like, the graphics annoy the crap out of me.
Where?
And when you go to get Sabin back, and you see Mansion, and then you go inside, and it's like... What is it, like 4 or 5 floors
that are bigger than the entire world map?
And you're like,
it's 2-story house.
Yeah, yeah, 2-story house.
And then it becomes massive manor.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, that's the only time. That's the only time.
How did you hold this building up?
Like,
this is like, been here for 7 days, getting kind of hungry.
Yeah.
That was one of those things you deal with when you talk about old games, though, too.
Like,
you have to use
Yeah,
imagination.
Even with that giant, like, what is it, 100-floor tower, you're like, okay, I see it on the world map, it's not going to be giantly huge, but, you know.
Oh, you're talking about the Tower of Magi?
Yeah, yeah, when you go there,
Fuck
it's like,
tower,
okay, you
way.
Know, the little sprite on the world map doesn't look that big. And then you go on and you're like, oh my god, I'm on floor 150, and I still got 3,000 more to go, oh god, I'm almost dying!
All we can do is hit stuff with magic.
Yeah.
The game took a lot of different liberties. They used the color palette to its absolute fullest. The spells looked great. The summons, there were a lot of summons that were slightly animated. Like, not a lot of them. A lot of them just went across the screen and whatnot, which was okay. But, like, okay, when you summon up something like Diablo or Alexander, Alexander actually would come out of the ground. Then the little things would open up, and he'd be like, the little things on his head, and like the little steam stacks. He would blow smoke, and then this little thing would light up. He'd shoot a laser across the field. Everything would explode, and then he would kind of like fade out like a mist. Like, that was a lot for back then, to have little bitty cutscenes like that inside of the game. And for that matter, all the character sprites had like a real emotion to them. Like... They were still 16-bit, and they were still kind... They were 16-bit drawn in, like, a strange 8-bit format, but it worked.
Yeah.
I can't fault... The only thing, if I had to try to fault it, I would say that they were still using cutout enemies. But...
Yeah, but...
I can't think of games that weren't at the time.
Plus, not to mention the fact that the game is so big. Yeah, well, I was about to say, at the same time, the game is so big... It really wouldn't surprise me if they used cutout enemies because, you know, for the simple fact of there's how many different enemies in the game?
You just said it there. The game being so big is another part of it.
Yeah.
Like, you can tell one house from another, and that doesn't sound like a big deal, but this
is Super Nintendo. Right. That's memory.
And there's little things like that, like the Opera House. There's nothing in the Opera House that is just simply recycled into some other house or other building. Like,
the Opera House had one of the coolest things ever because you had to run through the rafters.
Right.
Yeah.
And when you're in the rafters, you actually saw everything scroll underneath of you at the same time, and it was the shit that was going on right then and there.
It's also an iconic scene there.
When you beat the game, when the world ends, everything changes. And that's a big deal too, because
you get used to one world map and then suddenly, you know,
it changes.
Abroad! Yeah. I'm in the world of chaos. Where do I go now?
And literally everything about it is different. And even the towns you go to that you've already been to, none of them are the same. They went through the trouble of like breaking down every single town on the world map.
Yep.
So for the game's memory, I'm sure it was difficult because you're talking about every single town in the game, every building in the game was done twice.
Mm-hmm.
Every single one.
And that's also on top of the giant music scores, all of the everything, you know, like
being able to hold all the items.
They played around with camera aspects in this game too. Like one of the things they did when you got on the chocobo, they kind of tried to do like a 3D effect. I don't think it worked very well, but they tried.
Yeah, I was about to say it wasn't terrible.
The airship was a hell of a lot of fun too.
Oh yeah,
you can actually fly it up and down as you're flying through the world. You control it three dimensionally
with all the things with controlling the airship, as he said, and the fact that they changed the world and they had to go through and do every building twice, every area twice, and stuff like that. And with him saying the musical score, it really was the pinnacle of Super Nintendo. Probably one of the pinnacle games in the Super Nintendo library.
Top three games for the Super Nintendo, probably going to be FF6, Chrono Trigger, and probably Secret of Evermore.
Yeah,
Chrono Trigger was good.
Those are probably the top three games.
On your personal opinion, Secret of Evermore gets in there, but sadly, when you're talking about
most people probably be like, Secret of Mana was way better.
And they will. They will.
Technically.
I hated Secret of Mana.
I thought as soon as you said Evermore, I was like, no, fool, it's Mana.
See, that's what I mean.
See, I hated Mana.
Yeah.
Mana was garbage to me, but I played Secret of Evermore, which is almost another variant of Mana, and it was a lot more entertaining to me.
Yeah. See, now I
especially because
my dog changed constantly depending on what era I was in.
At the same time, I was also about to say you would technically have to label that as RPG because if you want to go top Super Nintendo, it would be FF6
and then Super Mario World. You're talking about what type of game is that back then? It was still very new. They barely were even understanding what they were doing with it. You're looking at the hack and slash action RPG. Back then, it was not something that was normal. Like, either you were a platformer, or even when you're talking about something like Legends of Gaia. Illusions of Gaia, when you play that, they count it like an RPG. But it was more like an action-based game where you could level up your life points and things like that.
Yeah.
So it doesn't fall into the exact category, but what you're looking at was actually like stats and menus, but you control every battle aspect. It's not Chrono Trigger. Chrono Trigger, along with something like even Tales of Phantasia, is still more traditional RPG-based, but it's like a mid-system, like you control battle type of thing.
Yeah.
But these were the first games that really did that. And if I had to tell you what the best attempt at that was, it's probably a game that I might be the only one here that really played it. Terranigma.
I never got a chance to play it.
I heard of it, but I never played it.
Terranigma, I promise you, it's the pinnacle of those type of games on that system. It was incredibly rare, and the only reason I got to play it, emulation.
I'll tell you one game that was pretty decent, though. It was Live Alive.
I'm lost.
Yeah. I kind
of
figured.
And it was we're one of those sidetracking way more than normal.
I'll tell you about it later. Anyways, so we've seen our game, and it looks fucking amazing.
Yeah.
So now we're going to play the game. And you know what? One of the coolest aspects is, before FF7 and their materia system, before FF8 and their junction system, we had FF6. You throw an Esper on, you start learning a spell.
And?
You level up, you get a specific bonus to a stat as you level up.
Because yep. You have that guy equipped.
You throw Odin's second form because you decided to go get it. You get Raiden. You get plus 10% HP when you level up. Yeah. And you also learn the quick spell.
Yep. And it's also the only Final Fantasy where you can learn every single magic for
every single character.
You could have the brokest team ever.
Always
well,
dead.
The most broken team is just throwing an Aegis Shield on Sabin.
I always thought the
fucking Perry Ultima.
How do you do this shit? I always thought the broken.
Like, but you know, but yeah, that's him. I've tried it with other people. Been like, you know what? Celeste is gonna be my monster. She's gonna be my monster, and I give her that shield.
And then Ultima comes up and is like dead.
Yeah, she would die. Yep. But then like,
and then Sabin doesn't even have the Aegis Shield. And he's like, bing!
Yeah, he'll block things like Ultima. Somebody will be like flare, and he's like ting. I get fucked.
Yeah. He's like, I parried that shit. Everyone's like, how the fuck did you parry that? You're like, using fist as a weapon. He's like, I'm a pimp.
The way I beat the guy at the top of the tower the first time I played, it was luck. I went up there and I was like, ching, ching, ching. I fought him and he was like, oh no, I'm dead. But when he dies, he's like, Ultima. And I was like, you cocksucking prick.
And then kind of nowhere, Sabin goes.
And every single guy on my team was like, 9,999. And he was like in the middle of the screen. He was like, tink, no damage. Fuck the strongest spell in the entire game. No damage.
I still remember
while on top of it, for no mana, he could be like, bum rush.
Yep.
9,999 when you get it.
Yep.
Like
yep.
Right off the bat,
he's just like,
strongest attack in the game.
I'm gonna go Lee mode.
And it's free. It's fucking free.
Yep.
And if you
want to
be
know
even
how
more
to
broke,
put it in.
If you want to be even more broke, you take the fucking mime guy. Use mimic.
Go.
Yeah. And he can mimic the move. So fucking, I used to call him Blitz. I know what his name is, Sabin. But he'd jump up and be like bum rush. And immediately the other guy would follow him free. So that's 2,999s, followed by Terra being like, well, fuck it, Ultima, 9,999. And Celeste being like, Ultima, 9,999. You're dead.
Well, that's your Kefka. Then you take a couple more hits.
Yeah.
Unless you're, you know, using
unless
one
you
of three bullshit.
Yeah, unless you have
unless
Shadow.
Unless you're using one of three bullshit tactics. First bullshit tactic. You have Shadow throw the Atma weapon, instant KO, because it does incalculable damage.
Yep.
Dead.
That's how you beat it every time.
You use Setzer slots and magically get three Jokers, win the game,
because
you can do it. Or you turn Kayan, I think is his name, the swordmaster, the Bushido guy.
I've heard people call him Kayan. I've heard people say Kayan, and I've heard Cyan. Even on occasion, people call him Sign.
Well, regardless, the Bushido master, you turn his ass into an imp and use retort. He continuously counters until the enemies on the screen are dead.
Yep.
Victory.
Yeah, he like loses his fucking mind.
Yeah,
if he turns into an imp.
The joke is, it is called Imp Berserk.
He just continually attacks over and over and over again until the enemy is dead.
Yeah, he counters his own counters with counters.
Yep.
To counter more. Yo, dog, we heard you like counters. So we put some counters in your imp counters.
I think I would just use the Admiral one. I think I would just use Shadows.
Ah, well, it's more humorous to watch Imp Kayan go fucking bullshit batshit crazy.
Because
he's just like, pshing,
because
pshing,
I feel like the second
pshing,
one
you're like, what the dicks is going
jokers,
on?
That seems a lot harder.
Actually, it's not as hard as you think, because you could cheat the game when you're trying to do it. Now, you just rapidly tap pause. And when you see the Joker about to pop up, you just hit the A button when you unpause it.
Yeah.
It'll stop the slot right on it.
So what if I'm trying to play legit?
If you're trying to play legit, then either use the imp or you throw the weapon.
Nope. If you're playing it legit, you cannot use the imp. You cannot try the slot.
You actually would have to fight Kefka.
You cannot throw the sword.
You'd actually have to fight
Kefka. Why can't you throw the sword?
Because it's not legit. It is a
how
glitch.
How is
it?
Wait, but how is
it
that is not
a glitch?
Not
in the game why
it's not a glitch.
It does incalculable damage.
I've heard that was written into the game on purpose because you even have two chances to get it. One
yeah.
to equip and one to throw on purpose.
Yeah.
Regardless, it's a cheat.
Just
way,
like
so
technically,
it's not legit.
Just like
and
technically,
the sword
imp.
Only works on him. If you accidentally mess up and use it on the first form,
it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Well, it does damage, but it
right.
doesn't do.
Yeah.
You have to wait for
it doesn't do
form.
Like
yep.
ultra.
You have to
damage.
Wait for like what? God
that,
Kefka.
You have to climb.
Yes.
So
okay.
Kefka has three forms in his final bit. You go through the first little area. You fight a couple faces. Then you get bumped up to the second stage as you're ascending to heaven, in quotes.
Yeah.
And you fight the other faces there. And then you ascend to the top, where Kefka floats down in
nope.
full angelic form.
Nope. Bottom form is the base of the tree. You actually climb the tree of life. After you kill the base of the tree, you walk up to the branches. At the branches, you fight these, like, four or five different forms. They're all different deity-looking things. All, like,
yeah.
Greek gods type of things. When you climb that, you fight a final form, which is this dude.
Oh, yeah,
which I
three.
Think is... I don't know if it's supposed to be, like, a nod to, like, a savior or, like, a Jesus idea, but it's like a dude. He's almost lying in a bed, and there's, like, an angel thing above him that constantly heals him.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that one.
And then once you kill that, you
then
ascend
you...
to heaven.
And then Kefka's
god
form floats down. He's like, "What's up, my bitch children?" And you're like,
"Oh god,
I got this here sword, Shadow." He's like, "What?"
Six.
Like, throw the sword.
Six is one of those very few games that I did actually beat over and over and over.
Uh-huh.
Kind of like I did with four.
Yeah.
Kind of like I did with...
Nothing.
Now,
next.
Nothing. Why go on this tirade real quick? Because the gameplay of this game, remember how I said in part 4 every single guy had their kind of purpose?
Mm-hmm.
In part 6, they take that concept and expand it tenfold.
Yep.
There's every single guy in the game not only has a purpose, he had a mechanic.
Yep.
Blitz was played like a fighting game. I said it again, I'm sorry. I used that name for like fucking 12
Sabin.
Years. Sabin was played like a fighting game.
When
in order to do his attacks,
blitzes,
you had to do the Hadouken Kamehameha
down
move.
Toward.
It was down
to
toward and your A button. And then he would jump
and
actually power up and
yep.
shoot the Orable. If you wanted to do like...
Flame dance. It was
L-R-L-R-L-R-L-R-A, yeah.
Yep.
And then he did this weird flame dance where fire sprites fly across the screen.
He would. Yep. He was essentially... It was like a Ten Shinhan move. He would create a whole bunch of Auric clones of himself that were like fire, and they would run all over the screen, attacking in every
yep.
direction.
And then for Blitz, it was just a full circle, I think, is what
the
it was.
The bum rush was like, it was the most complicatedly difficult
yeah.
thing to get because the D-pad, you had
was
to master exactly, you had to master exactly what they wanted. You had to like start with Tord and roll all the way around back to Tord and then hit the A button or something like that. And I can't remember if it was clockwise or counterclockwise, but if you missed even one direction in the middle of it, he wouldn't do it.
Yep.
But...
And you can use suplex on a train.
That's
yeah,
just
use suplex trains.
That was him.
The best.
That's just him. We're not. There's a gambler who
that's
actually
Setzer
used slots
yep.
and darts. He
and
would
it
actually
a,
throw dice at people's
it,
faces.
But it was actually a gamble. You
yep.
could kill yourself using the character, or you could heal, or you could cause damage, or you could get stat buffs or stat decreases.
Let's
yep.
see. One of the big things, if I remember right, the
king.
Accidental instant death thing
Edgar.
For Setzer was Joker bar.
Yeah.
And
I thought
the
it
second
was...
you see that, you're like, fuck! Because
it
instantly kills you.
I thought it was three bars.
No. Three bars is a good thing.
Yeah.
It's Joker bar. If you get that, your entire party gets wiped instantly.
I don't know how to get it, but you can also do a summon with him that brings in these three like Avenger guys, and they will kill the shit out of the enemy. And
I'm trying to remember, I think it's hard to get though. I mean,
it's
I think
incredible.
It's,
yeah. I've seen it twice.
I think it's
in all the years I've played it, and the first time I ever seen it, I was so excited. Because he did, like, this summon thing, and I was like, I'm the best! And then all of a sudden, like, 5,000s came across my team, and I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah, whooped your own ass.
Yeah, whooped my own ass.
Edgar, the King of Figaro, Sabin's brother, he uses tools, because he's a mechanic.
Yeah.
He got chainsaws and stuff.
He's a machinist. Mm-hmm. But it's like, you start off, get a auto crossbow. That is the most broke fucking thing to use in the very beginning of the game.
Yeah.
Because I'm playing through on the Android right now. And I'm just like, alright, Locke, you're worthless. You can't steal for shit, so swing a sword. Tara, who I named Tina because that's a real name, you can serve your magic. Just swing a sword.
Yep. Oh,
Edgar,
later on,
shoot that bow!
Later on, she can actually become an Esper.
Well, she's Esper.
Right, but later on, she can actually become an Esper.
Yeah, she can actually turn into
during battle, and it doubles the power of your magic for a time.
Then you've got Locke, and what Locke can do is
nothing.
Steal.
And that is
even, can't steal.
Even if you put two bandanas on him, which bandanas allow you to steal better, he still can't fucking steal.
Actually, my Locke can steal on the Android, so I think they bumped up his steal rate.
Oh, so they finally fixed it? Oh, yep.
Well, I was able to steal a mithril knife from the guard boss.
Then
we had to protect Tara.
We've got Celeste.
I was like, yay, mithril soul.
Celeste is cool. She can runic.
Runic.
It's like, oh, boss guy, he's going to use that ultimate move next turn because I'm about to kill him. I'm going to use Runic.
Actually,
kill that guy. Brom! Runic.
It won't absorb Ultima.
Yeah.
What?
It only absorbs magic with an elemental power. There's like a couple magic spells that deal like physical and ultimate damage.
And ultimate. And Ultima does
get
that.
Hit by it.
Yeah.
And it really pisses you off when it happens.
Especially if you try like what you said, and it's like, why the fuck didn't it do that?
Because like, that was one of the first things I ever tried when I got up to that guy the second time, and I was like, well, I'm just gonna runic, and that thing won't fucking hit me anyway. And I was like, she was like, ka-ching, and did her little thing, and I was like, now I'm invincible, bitch. And he was like, Ultima, bitch. And I died.
It was like
you
dead.
Fucking cock.
Yeah.
Then you got somebody like Shadow who can.
Throw shit. He's the ninja.
But he actually got a couple interesting things. He could throw weapons, but he also had throw items. And the items were different. He was unique where he could use like an invis edge.
Yep.
And when he used throw, it would turn him invisible.
Or, it would give him the vantage status. Or he could throw the water edge, which was basically a water scroll. Does flood damage.
Right, which was a lot like using the magic attacks from Edge.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's basically what they did. They're like, all right, how do we give him ninjutsus without making them jutsus?
Oh, gameplay also, you had to buy his services.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He could leave at any time.
Until a certain point in the game.
Yeah, we had that problem once or twice where we'd buy him, get into that forest, fight one battle, and he's like, alright, I'm done with you, fuck.
Shit, forest nothing. The most pissed I've ever been in my entire life at that game was I got to him, and I was like, I'm gonna fucking Shadow this motherfucker up. Because Shadow was my favorite guy, and I didn't know you could get him at the end of the world at the time. So I was like, I'm gonna use the crap out of Shadow. So I saved all my money, like all the way up to that point. I didn't buy anything. I got there, and I was like, brrr, brrr, brrr. Buying all this idolized items to throw and whatnot, and I was like, yeah, that's fucking sweet. So I go out onto the world map, and literally the first fight, it's like bleh, bleh, and like a couple little guys appear, and one guy tried to hit Shadow. They got first attack. He blocks. Ting! And a little dog goes by. Bark, 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 bite, bark, bark. That guy dies, and he walked to the middle of the screen, and I was like, what's going on? He's like, I've earned my keep. And he left. And I was like, what the fuck? He's like, you get your ass back here. You don't
what
do
the fuck,
one
guy.
When he left in the middle of the first fight after killing one guy, lost him off my team.
Uh-huh.
But then once
I had not saved. because I had the game down to such a science that I could literally play for like 12 hours and not have to worry about dying.
But then when you if you wait for him and the floating continent, and
with like 5 seconds left before the continent decides to start crashing,
you will get him permanently.
Wait.
Yes.
And it'll have an option saying wait for Shadow. He'll jump in.
It's what?
You do not get him permanently at that point.
Well,
because the world ends.
Yes.
But you have the ability to go save him from the two King Behemoths. And then you get his sword thingy from Interceptor, which is his dog. And then you go to the Colosseum, bet that, beat Shadow, get Shadow.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, Shadow's a little more complicated
to get.
He is
like the bullshit.
Actually,
side
if I remember
quest,
correctly,
but he is so fucking worth it.
If I remember correctly, you don't even have to beat Shadow. You just got to last so long in the fight, and then he's like, "Yeah, I remember you guys. You're worth my time."
Then
fight done.
No, he's more like, "Yeah, I'm kind of tired of whooping your ass."
Then you've got somebody like Go-Go who can mimic.
Go-Go, the way to get him is you get sucked up by a zone eater.
Yeah.
In the desert, and
then
you walk
like,
through the cave.
And then, like, takes you to a secret, like...
takes you to a secret cave, just what about that? Cave, like, hey, go, join me. So he's then, like, I will mimic all of your bullshit!
Who am I missing? I'm trying to think.
Gal?
No.
Was
next.
Lame as shit.
Yeah,
next.
There's Gal, who's your blue mage. Moving along.
Gal
was
not
the blue mage.
He's a new...
He was the enemy skill master.
Whether you like him or not, he is a new idea, which is not utilized in many games. Any enemy that you fight.
On the Veldt.
Any enemy that you fight. Well, but throughout the Veldt, especially at the end of the world, you could basically get almost every monster in the game.
Yeah.
If you fight them on the Veldt and you send him to live with them, when he comes back...
He knows their special move.
Right. So, okay, you fight him. You fight Magitek Armor throughout the course of the game. Magitek Armor has three moves. Well...
You can learn Magitek Missile.
If you send him to live with Magitek... When he comes back, you can turn him into that enemy. So the unique thing is, like, he's super versatile once you learn what's going on. Let's say that you're in trouble and there's a whole bunch of water guys everywhere. You could turn him into a ghost, which uses an awful lot of lightning attacks. Or if you want to get crazy about it, turn him into that electric rhino thing. Any enemy that you fight in the game that he can go live with, he can come back, and you could basically add that enemy to your team.
Now, the best thing to do with Gal, which is what I do every fucking playthrough, is while you're in the underwater trench going away, you make him jump. He never comes back.
I know we don't like him, Bill, and I know you like him.
It's not that I like him.
Yeah,
don't
I was about to say.
He's not a guy I put on my team very often. In fact, I find him as super unique but inconvenient because it takes, believe it or not, you kind of have to study to use the character. I remember when I got real serious about the game, when I said, I'm going to 100% this fucking game, I actually had a notebook and I would send him to live with an enemy. He would come back, I would check his skill list and add the monsters to my list, then I would use them in battle. And every single move they used, I would copy the move that they used, and whether they had stat damages or something, and then I would code that into my book so that later on in the game when I was using him, if I came across an enemy and I'd be like, I need this, and I would open my book and look for the monster that had the move set that I needed the most and use him.
Okay.
Like, he's incredibly good, but... You have to be willing to put a lot of fucking time into him, and in the long run, it's not worth it.
Blue mage is Strago.
Who else am I missing?
Strago uses lore, which you have to get Goblin Punched in the dick to be able to use Goblin Punch.
Which hurts the dick, by the way.
Yeah.
I can only imagine.
especially with him being an old man.
Especially him, because I think he's like
ancient.
Fucking 65.
No, he's like in his 80s.
Yeah.
He's old as fuck.
You might be pushing.
No, that's, I was about to say, if anything, he's around like 70.
I know that Final Fantasy 6 had quite a few characters.
Gameplay aspect is a little bit of storyline, but it's more gameplay. There is no main character.
They're all main characters.
Right.
Which, like, is actually something that they didn't do until...
Except for Locke, who thinks he is the main character.
No, that's why we throw him off the
table. But what I mean is that You can just pick any team you want. Yep. You are never tied down to a point, unless storyline specific, you are never tied down to a point where they're like, you must be this guy.
No. Yeah. No. Like,
when you pick your team.
When you first end up in the World of Ruin, you're stuck with Celeste. Which a lot of people really have a problem with.
There's a reason why.
Yeah.
But.
Before then, though, there's a spot where the party splits up into three. You have three different stories to play all at once.
Yeah.
And before you can continue the actual game. Locke
goes by himself because he thinks he's some sort of a hard-ass, but he's not.
He's the one that runs into Celeste, right?
He's the one that rescues Celeste. She's due to be killed.
Okay.
Yeah.
He runs
around. So he's got his marriage.
The one time Locke actually can steal is when he robs people of the clothes on their back.
I don't like Locke.
I fucking hate that
guy. Once we get to storyline, he is extraordinarily important and interesting.
Yeah. Well, on top of that, he's the only reason why you get the Phoenix summon, too.
Which I said was interesting. Yeah. There's a reason for all
that. Oh, another gameplay thing I just thought of. It was something that was unique, and I don't believe any Final Fantasy did it until 6. I might be wrong on this. As you know, I didn't play the older ones that much.
Well, I did.
Two players.
Yeah, it was the first one. That was the first one.
Yeah, but...
Could you do that in 5?
You could not.
I think you can do that in 5.
You could do that later versions of 5, probably, but you could not do that in original 5. 6 was the very first one you played two-player.
No, that is for the Super Nintendo, because we're talking Super PS1.
Nintendo was the first time.
Okay.
I wouldn't six be able, the only one. Reason I can't cop to this is because we didn't get 5 on Super Nintendo. But when we
I
got
played
it on,
the ROM for
when we got it on the when we got it on the Sony, there was the two-player option, and there was the two-player option on 6. And if I'm to believe that they were adding two-player options by this time, then 7 would have had it. And 8 would have had it, and 9 would have had it.
They decided against it and make it more...
But then why has it never made it into 4? This is why I don't think that that option was added to 5. I think it might have been there. Because 4, even in the remakes, does not have a two-player option, ever.
But I thought that was kind of neat, that 6 had a two-player option, because you and me sat down...
And you could...
You pick two characters.
One person could do the dungeons, one person could do the world map.
And then when battles come...
The characters were divided amongst the players so that... You could actually, you know, have a friend over that didn't sit for 60 hours. He could, you know,
because,
I don't know, play for
because
60 hours.
Sitting watching an RPG, it has to be a really good RPG.
It has to be a really good
It can't
good
be something
RPG.
Like, I don't know, Dragon Quest.
Like,
watching Final Fantasy IV.
I was going to say, what sucks is to watch somebody like the disembodied voice fucking level grind for... 30 plus hours. That's not fun.
On Final Fantasy 12?
Yes.
Wow. And how did I know this? Oh, wait. Because you had to level grind for fucking license points to wear a goddamn hat!
Because he had to fight a turtle.
And we'll talk about that when we get to 12.
He kept killing him. So he kept training and kept fighting a turtle and kept training and kept fighting a turtle. And I was like, by now I would have turned this fucking game off.
Now...
Oh yeah, Shane, when are you giving Bill that copy of 12 that you
I will with? Actually, when we're done with everything, I'll actually run home and get it, since I don't live that far. I'm only like 5 minutes away.
You know what? That would be great, because then we'll put it in and make
Now, play. Here's the thing.
You ain't going to make me do anything on that faggoty-ass game. I'm
now,
playing.
I did watch Bill play an RPG, and it was boring, but then it was interesting when he got towards the end. I watched Bill beat Dragon Quest VIII.
Oh.
And it's not fun. It's not fun to watch him play the game because so much level grinding.
Oh my god, there is.
So much level grinding.
Basically, this is the way I look at Dragon Quest. Dragon Quest is, you know how miles per hour works, right?
Yeah.
Dragon Quest has a levels per hour system. For every hour of continuous level grinding, you will get one level.
Yep. Unless you magically find Metal King Slimes.
I'm telling you.
Those are
you get like three levels.
When you play the game,
how often do you run into them?
I was able to look at it. I remember I started figuring it out because I started looking at the hours when I would load the game and I'd be like, 34 hours. I'm level 34. Then like later on I was like, 48 hours. I actually am level 48. By the time I was 67 hours in, I was actually level 67. I was like, what the fuck? I get one fucking level an hour. Like, it is very accurate.
Then what you need to do is you need to set the controller down and come back after like 12 hours. And, hey, I'm level 12. I just started the game. Fuck yeah.
Now, go fight, I did watch.
Enemy. Bam, level 12.
Watching that game was boring, but then when he got to the end, was interesting. Because that dude was broke.
Oh my god.
But it was fun to watch.
Yeah. I'm sure it was fun to watch.
Yeah.
I didn't have to do it.
It wasn't so great to do
it. Well, here's the problem with Dragon Quest VIII. I played it, but I can't remember how far I got. I honestly can't.
I was getting ready to go into the final dungeon, but you don't know where the memory card went.
Motherfucker?
Yeah. Dude, I played it, and I was like...
What if they released that on the Vita? No upgrades, just simply straight to the marketplace so you could level grind...
Well,
level grind.
Didn't you just tell everybody in like the last podcast we did
that you would buy it? But how many hours, how many levels do you think you'd get into it?
Like, the story's pretty good.
I must level up.
You get to like the third big guy, and if all you've been doing is going through the game,
you die.
He will. There's no fucking chance.
But like, yeah. It's fun to watch certain
just
games.
Just make your character.
It has
Super
to be
Saiyan.
Like, I don't have a problem watching. Like, if Bill sat down and played Final Fantasy VI, I could sit and watch.
Oh, dude, we could all sit and watch.
But being a part of it was fun too.
Right. Yeah.
Sitting down and picking two characters.
Too.
Because we all know the best character in the game is Setzer, right? Yep. Okay, moving on.
I'm prone to Sabin myself. I think he's the
look before.
Thing
before
the
I put
Setzer flies an airship.
Look, let me put it
Sabin
to you this way:
Sabin duplexes traits.
Flies two airships.
Flies two.
Only now, one that's got him. Only one that's got him.
And Sabin suplexes traits.
Yeah, I was
Sabin
about to say.
Suplex the airship.
That's what I was about to be like.
Yeah.
Let he'd be on the ground. Ship. He'd be on the ground and Setzer would be like, "What the hell, bitch?"
Oh,
he'd be like, "Suplex."
And he'd be like this. Oh shit.
Oh shit.
He'd be like, "Why are we upside down?"
Yeah.
What the fuck is there?
I'm like 5,000 feet in the air. How'd you get up here? Yeah.
Have you know something I noticed about the airships in Final Fantasy VI?
What's that?
All the other airships. Six is the last time I can think of where you're outside to pilot the airship. After that, there was always some sort of cockpit or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In Final Fantasy VI, it was the last time where that
it
dude
was an actual
had just a big steering
a
wheel up on the top of that motherfucker. And he was just like, I'm going to go up there and enjoy the wind.
Yeah, it's basically what it was a giant boat.
Right.
A big propeller on the back and a big-ass hot air balloon.
But I will say that it was the very first time that it looked
good,
like an airship. Like,
yeah.
The other ones, I was always kind of like,
well, yes.
What about the airships in 4? A boat with propellers.
Yeah.
Well, that's what exactly what it looked like.
Their engine room is most of the belly of the ship.
Yeah.
It's literally giant turbines.
I'll give you that, but... Just because we like Final Fantasy and look into it that deep doesn't mean that the average person is going to be like, why is the boat flying?
Yeah.
Oh, it's because there's actually all these things at the bottom of the ship. It's the belly of the ship. Like, they don't know that ship. There's two propellers sticking out the top of this boat.
Yes. And because we
all... An old-style fucking pirate.
And Noah's Ark. Wait.
Like,
mind you, you cannot land in the ocean with
like
this ship.
If we put two propellers on the Black Pearl, we're Final Fantasy.
That would be awesome! Do pirate ship!
I'd break down those masts and put on some propellers and be like,
while you bastards are doing that, I'm gonna go down to the...
But then you've got Final Fantasy VI that changed it a little bit.
Well, they became
with the hot air balloon.
It's basically a zeppelin.
And then
just a hell of a lot faster.
I don't give a fuck. I'm jumping.
And then, with less explosion.
But look, it doesn't matter. I'm still going to go get some pirate metal before
like
we take off in the ship.
I think the first time it actually looked like an airship was 7.
Well, 7 seven-headed unique...
The High Wind!
I think the High Wind is slightly copied from the first ship that you pilot. Not mostly, but the bottom of it. I think a lot of it's copied from what it was in 6.
It was, but like, instead of the big giant boat balloon thing, you had two jet engines. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And then, of course, they completely did a 180.
But the cockpit was based out of that.
That thing was sweet, though.
Yeah.
The Ragnarok?
Yeah, the spaceship.
That was awesome.
You're like, I got a spaceship that looks like a dragon. Oh, by the way, it shoots motherfucking lasers out its mouth.
So then I pose a question.
Go ahead.
Oh, actually, I forgot a couple characters. You can actually pick up Mog, the Moogle.
Yeah, you can pick up the Moogle.
He dances.
You can pick up the Yeti.
And you can pick up the Sasquatch Yeti guy called Umaro. Oh.
However, you also did forget about the old man's granddaughter.
Hold on.
Certain parts of the game
There are certain guys that can actually team with each other. And the Sasquatch is one of the rare characters that actually teams with Mog. So if they're both on the team, it actually raises their stats.
Now, does Mog ride on the Yeti?
No.
Mog does a dance and the Yeti summons a blizzard.
And every now and then, like, they'll do joint attacks. Like, the Sasquatch will get pissed. Like, he'll get hit, and he'll be like, fuck that! And he'll do this type of thing, run down and grab Mog, and throw Mog while Mog, like, flies with the spear. And be like, dead, bitch!
That's awesome.
Oh, God! Use the lance quickly!
Never got far enough to get him.
Actually,
now that you talk about that, he's a boss character that you can make. Okay, in Final Fantasy VI, there is a mime that you never need to pick up.
Yeah.
There's the Sasquatch you never need to get.
You don't have to get Mog.
You can leave Mog behind.
You can leave Mog behind.
There's three characters.
You can leave Gal behind.
You could get Mog and then have the chance to get Umaro, or you can get a charm or something like that from Mog instead.
Right, but what I'm talking about is, like, it's amazing how many characters...
There's five characters.
You've already got five characters that are just... You want to expand your story.
On top of that, once you hit the World of Ruin...
You can leave Locke. In the World of Ruin, you only have to pick up three characters. Yeah, you don't actually have to beat the game with Locke. But there's a terrible thing that happens here. Say you actually only get three characters. Let's say you do.
Well, you get Celeste automatically.
Celeste, Sabin, and Terra.
You absolutely cannot do it without Setzer because you can't reach the final battle
without four characters.
Yeah. You have to have.
Gotta have him.
You have to have that bitch voice so you can use him for his airship.
He's not a bitch until Kingdom Hearts. Calm down. Let's say you do this. Let's say you have a total of four people. The final level is so large...
You need two parties.
Three parties.
Oh, yeah. Is it three?
But just like they did the first time. Three parties.
Oh, yeah, it's two parties on the floating continent. It's three parties in the final
dungeon. All three of them have to work together. These guys actually have to reach a certain point to activate certain things that will allow for other paths to open for party two
and party three.
And party three has to activate very specific paths that will allow party one to go forward so that party two can finally move forward.
So they all... It's nothing more than a maze, pretty much. You've got to move each character till one team gets to the final place.
Think about doing that with only four characters to split into three teams.
You would have one team with two people.
And two teams with one person.
Sven! That way. Got it.
That legit is the only one that would work. Sabin, go there. Got it.
Got it.
2 hours later, there's just a mountain of bodies.
Sabin's like, oh no, Ultima! Bing!
But Sabin would still end up dying because, like, you would have to somehow make it through the entire ship with only Celeste.
Yep.
Ooh. Runic is not going to save you
when ninja shows up.
But then your second
is one of my all-time favorite characters in Final Fantasy history. Has nothing to do with her performance. She will get destroyed. She's not one of the stronger characters.
If you're doing that with a four-party team,
and that was like, yeah, actually.
So what you're telling me doesn't offer much protection. So what you're telling me is that if you chose those four characters to go to the to do that last place, you would send Sabin on his own, Celeste on her own, and then you would team up Terra and Setzer.
Yeah.
Slots and magic.
That's one magical slot.
One group has to be crippled.
Yeah. And that would be Celeste's.
So you have to give Tina to one or the other. It's either two magic ladies or a magic lady and a gambler.
Because I don't think because I like Setzerline. He's my favorite.
Or you could switch it around and you could put Celeste on one of those two teams.
I like Setzer's my favorite character in six.
I was about to say, no, it is bad.
When you get to that final place, like there are trick enemies in the final level of the game, and I do mean trick. It pisses you off something fierce.
Basically.
No. There's a dragon. It'll appear on your screen.
I like dragons.
Okay. When you kill it, it doesn't die.
That sucks.
Know why?
Because it vanishes.
Because there are actually seven dragons. But what they do is they stack all the cardboard cutouts in one single frame. So when you hit it and it dies, it'll go and do that little fadeaway thing, but its picture's still there.
So you gotta kill seven dragons.
So you'll be like, what the fuck?
Or you have that stupid dragon that when you kill it, it gets the vanish status. But at that point, you're just like, oh, I know how to handle this. Doom, instant kill, victory, let's go.
That's true.
That was actually, I forgot about that one. Cast Vanish and then Doom on an enemy, it will kill them.
Right, Vanish I've
makes
heard
you
about
invincible
that
to all physical attacks, right. But it makes you absolutely susceptible to every spell in the
it
game.
It gives you a one. Now listen to this.
Only use Vanish against physical people.
No, this
people.
Is funny. The game actually has this exact mechanic. In Vanish, you have 100% dodge rate against all physical, but 100%, they have a 100% hit rate for any magic attack.
Yep.
Unless you are Sabin.
Yep.
Yeah, Sabin's kind of broken.
I have been vanished with Sabin, where I made everybody
and
invisible so that they couldn't
parried.
Be hit. And he'll be standing there, and they'll try to hit him with the physical attack. And even though he can't be hit by it, he'll still be like, ting, and block it anyway. Just to
it's
be
like
a dick, parried. I guess.
Like, hey, you can't hurt me.
Magical shield.
Everybody else. But then they'll use, like, flare on your party, and it'll be like, doo-doo-doo, and everybody will get hit, and he'll be like, ting.
It's no. Like, I ain't doing that.
I don't give a fuck. 100%
fuck
nothing.
Yep.
I block 100% it. Suck these nuts.
And then you gotta think that enemy was like,
that enemy's
damn
like,
it.
Shit!
I don't know what they did when they programmed him, but he is the brokest thing in
he's,
Final
he's
Fantasy
the Bruce
history.
Lee.
In truth?
He's the Bruce
in
Lee
truth,
in Final Fantasy.
It's why he couldn't be in Dissidia.
It's why he couldn't be in Dissidia.
Because if you had to go, because they went through, and they picked characters from certain games, and they picked Terra, duh.
You knew she was, because she was the representative for the game. You got the hero representative and the evil representative
Here's the problem,
for each
though.
Game.
Here's the problem, though. When you look at one through, because
well,
the newest
no,
one put 13.
We really didn't get a hero representative for one. Yeah, we got some bullshit guy who didn't exist.
But they already fixed that because they put him in his original armor.
Yeah.
He's the warrior of... So we got the Warrior of Light for that one. But what I'm getting at is, like, 6 was one of them different games. Because 6 did not have one
but
main character.
Terra, no.
You do start the game
no,
with Terra.
If you look at the splash screen, like they have for every single Final Fantasy, like
she's
7...
She's the Magitek armor on
the
title.
She's the Magitek
screen.
Armor person on that, whereas, like... 7, you had the meteor. 4, you had, fuck, I don't even remember 4. I should know this one better than anything.
Yeah, you should.
5 was the chocobo.
Airships?
No, in airships. I just brain.
Fairy looking guy in a paladin's costume.
That was better than that faggy ass, lame ass, worthless piece of shit, Dragoon.
No, Dragoon the badass, Kane.
Chihiro used his entire breath to insult your character, like literally had to breathe immediately after he was done with his insult.
Fucking hate that goddamn worthless.
Dragoons are awesome.
Dragoons
Kane
are awesome.
Kane is awesome.
Kane was a worthless dragoon.
I feel like 4 was Rydia.
We're talking about a paladin and a dragoon, not a summoner.
No, he was talking about for what he would consider the hero of that game.
Rydia?
He considers it more
Rydia. On the splash screen, I feel like it was Rydia, if I'm not mistaken.
It might have been.
Well, it might have been
I
actually.
Look it up later.
I don't know, because Cecil looked like a chick too, so I mean, really.
It's better than Mr. I gotta hide my face the entire game because I'm too much of a pansy.
No, that's a hard ass. That's a hard ass.
I'm, We beat the final boss, Saint World. I'm gonna go stand up on a mountain and cut my wrist for 20 fucking
can't.
Years.
Wrist is covered with armor, doesn't remove it. So it's like, ting, ting, ting.
Yeah, that's how stupid that motherfucker is. Another thing real quick. That was lame.
Was that Bowser?
No.
No, that's Calico.
No.
No? Alright. Anyways, no.
Holy shit.
If you do like Dragoons, if you really like the Dragoons
class. Shut him up
class,
for a second, though.
Hold on. If you really like the Dragoon class, you can give a character the relic Dragoon Boots, and it will change their attack command to jump. That's another cool thing.
Anybody in Final Fantasy VI can be altered into a dragoon.
It's any character. You're like, you know what?
Jump is very handy.
It's funny. Or you can just use Gao and he'll jump and leave the screen.
Give counter and jump to Sabin. It's funny because every time they try to hit him, he'll be like, ting, bweep, badow! Instantly come down with the x3 damage. And then you'll do the normal thing with him, too, and be like, jump. So he'll jump, be gone for a turn, come down with x3 damage, and immediately they'll be like, oh, kill that guy. Ting! And he's like, bitch! And he'll just go across the whole fucking enemy map like, I don't give a fuck.
Okay, actually, wait. There was
you can put drain claws on him, so every time he does it, he's healing himself, too.
These guys are like, oh, he didn't block, guys!
Oh, and he can also equip two weapons, so you can give him two claws. He can heal himself and cause physical damage, so you're guaranteed to hurt anything in the game.
Yep.
And heal.
And heal at the same time. And jump. And counter, and block magic.
If you can talk,
Lock has one really useful thing that I almost
broker
forgot about.
Charisma.
Two Genji gloves.
Oh, yeah.
Two twin lances.
Yeah.
Twin lance, you attack twice. Genji gloves, you attack twice.
Yep.
Oh, that's
put
right.
Two
doesn't
of those.
Get, like, eight attacks?
Double attack for each hand, so that's four.
And then
you do it one more time. Because you put two Genji gloves on him.
Yep.
So you're attacking like 16 times right there. You're like, hit, 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 hit. You're like, wow, I'm doing meager damage, but I'm whooping these motherfuckers' asses.
Because it all adds up.
I thought I remembered it being eight times in all, because you can only put two relics on.
Yeah.
And if you're equipping two weapons, and you get the chance to hit twice, he does... Like, at the most, he'll do, like, eight. I can't remember. There's a way to get it to work.
Oh, wait, no, because usually you can only get, like, one Genji glove, unless you're super lucky. So that's probably what it was.
And the cool thing about it is, even though he kind of sucks, you can give him these weapons called, like, the Full Moons and set him in the back row so he takes almost no damage at all.
And he just kind of whips.
And then he'll... But he still attacks as if he was in the front row.
Yep.
But...
Yeah, he throws chakras.
And he still doesn't do as much damage as fucking Sabin.
But we went
suplex!
We went through all the characters, I believe.
Basically,
I think so, yeah.
Gameplay for
this. I can double check.
This game has so much.
It was refined so well, there's never a moment in the game where you feel like you don't have control, and there's never a moment in the game where there isn't something new to pique your interest, such as this was the first time in the history of Final Fantasy to include something that everybody seems stuck on now.
Mm.
Final Fantasy 7, 8, 9, what'd you get? Even 10.
Chocobo, airship.
No, during battle, take so much damage.
Oh, no.
A limit.
It was not a limit break. It was a desperation attack that triggered extremely rarely.
And it still existed first
in
Final Fantasy VI. If you were in yellow life, almost dead,
you could
hit fight.
Usually under a status effect usually helps.
There was a
rarely
chance
when you attack
that you would do
a desperation move.
You would do a desperation attack, a limit break, which was an outrageous fucking attack.
Sabin, when he does his, it's hilarious. He does Tiger Claw.
Well, like, hold on.
And he goes, BROMP!
It was different in 7. Because 7 actually gave you a meter. When you right. Once your meter got up.
Eight was you just had to be tap triangle.
Well, that but it was
no,
easier.
No, period.
No,
anytime you just tap triangle.
Well, I understand that, but it was easier. No, if you
tap less life you have, the
easier
more
it was
often
to
your limit will trigger, but you can have your limit trigger at full life.
You can, but it's real difficult. I mean, cuz
you
might
just throw on aura and then just constantly trigger it.
Yeah. That would
Thank
do
you.
It.
Thank you, by the way. I appreciate that, guys.
What?
Cuz Like you guys don't already know that I'm going to attack Final Fantasy VIII and you give me something more to hate
That's
about
fine.
It?
That's fine.
You can attack
you,
it all you want,
eight.
But here's the problem.
Fucking faggot.
You're going to be wrong.
Sure.
But
I've
here's...
I've already told
you. You wait
till
we're
to break work. This game.
You just wait. We're going to... We'll be there soon.
That game sucks selfies balls. Period.
All zero of them.
Yeah, because that was a girl.
Selfie looks like a dude.
Cecil looks like a girl, but you know, you're okay with that.
I'm gonna flip you out of the fucking chair. Hey, at least he tries to look good.
You don't need to
Kane's
attack
so
me
goddamn
about Cecil.
Ugly, he has to put a fucking helmet on and keep it on.
When you have a dragon helmet,
game.
You wanna wear it!
Not when it's the remake, because he looks gay as fuck.
I think he would look about retarded in a dress.
I would wear it!
Honestly. Like, he's just trying to be at work and shit with his dragon helmet.
Like, what are you doing? Looking cool!
Looking cool!
I'm King!
I feel as though I could go on a beer run and they'll still be arguing about this right now.
Anyways.
Back to 6.
There's so many
Jesus.
Cool mechanics in 6, it's not funny.
Now, there is... I figured this was... I told you this was going to be the longest Final Fantasy we've done
yeah.
yet.
Well, because
actually,
there's so many good things to talk about.
It really is.
That was gameplay. We are actually needing to move to our next
story.
Section. We need
yeah.
to talk story. Now, hold on.
Yeah, before we get into this, I just want to say I'm still stuck on a game that he mentioned earlier. Terra Nigma.
Terra Nigma.
No, disembodied voice said...
Terra Nigga.
And that is what the game is!
God damn it. God damn it.
But no.
Moving along!
Story of Fandom Night, where racial slurs also flow free.
We need to talk story. However,
it's complicated.
This game is not only a long game,
yes,
and a large game,
and a fun game.
It is a massively philosophical and deep game. There's a
yeah.
lot of stuff going on here that's almost impossible to comment too far on. This is one of those things where the story is actually so amazing, and the gameplay loans itself to the story so well that it's almost impossible to break this thing down, except for just to mention very specific moments. But even then, you're giving away stuff that's...
Yeah.
This game is unreal. Like, people that haven't played it...
Need to play it.
...have missed out severely.
I'm going to tell you all this right now. If you don't have a Super Nintendo, PS1, or Game Boy Advance, or a smartphone, which...
You
don't have a
smartphone.
Shame on you.
Smartphone and play it.
Now,
you can go and pick it up for the SNES, the PS1, the Game Boy Advance, or the smartphone.
It,
yeah.
is on, it is on the SNES, it is on the Game Boy Advance,
PS1.
It is on the PSP, it is on the PS1,
the PS3.
It is on the PS3.
Technically, with,
3,
the PS Network, yes.
Yeah, it is on the
yes.
Vita, it is on the Go.
I'm still so butthurt.
There's only like two. There's only two people I know that have a Go.
I kind of wish
I
had a Go.
50% of that,
and I'm the other.
You know what? I wish I had a Go because my PSP. I have a 256 megabyte mem card.
But here's the problem.
I can't download my Final Fantasy IV Complete Collection.
But here's the problem.
And it pisses me off
because
I have a PSP with 32 gigs of storage.
Holy
dicks.
Jesus!
But since I make the other.
You.
50% of who owns a Go. I don't know where mine's at right now.
I know where mine's at.
Where's yours?
It's being loaned to Spencer because he... Are you not... Ready?
Ready.
Because he'd never played Pokemon Ruby Destiny.
And our Go's are a little different because they have special games on them.
Listen here. Sony dropped the fucking ball. I support my gaming companies. I do. I do not hack my systems. I don't fucking alter my PS3s or some shit like that. I leave the shit alone and I support the fucking company. I try to be as legit as I possibly can. But when you shit right in my fucking open mouth with that piece of garbage.
You shouldn't have had your mouth open.
I hacked the fuck out of that thing. I gave it to somebody that knew what they were doing. I said, make this a Super Nintendo. Make this a Sega. Make it a Game Gear. Make it a Game Boy Advance. Make it a Game Boy.
Make it a Game Boy Color.
Make it an NES. Make the motherfucker an Atari. Do that for me. And he gave that shit back to me. And it was like music and systems that were worth taking with me. And with that motherfucker having a battery life that lasts like 7 to fucking 12 goddamn hours, 3 different settings on the screen, and the fact that I can turn it off at any time,
means
it has never been more awesome to play Dragon Warrior 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6.
Dragon Warrior 1 sucked a dick.
It's awesome to have every single Shining Force right on one single system. Sure is nice to play Sonic on my Go. Take that shit with me.
Gotta go fast.
Everyone likes Sonic.
On my Go.
No. Everyone likes Sonic until Sonic 06. And then everyone hates Sonic.
Everyone liked old Sonic.
Well, that just happens to be what's on my Go. Oh, and the Sonic Advances. Yep. Those are sweet.
I'm going to just put my feet up here and just rest them on the table.
It's good to have 3 versions of Super Mario World on one system.
3 versions?
My Go.
Yeah.
My Go has only games that I really wanted to play.
Oh, and it's fun to have Japanese games. Japanese games!
That you can't read or understand what the fuck's going on.
Like playing the new Gundam games is pretty fucking sweet.
The fact that you have it.
On my Go.
On the Go.
Look.
Playing the Go.
By the way, if we haven't beat this one thing to death already.
It pisses me off.
Yeah, well, we still have, 4 more hours that we need to spend talking storyline in FF6.
It's one of the biggest fucking drops of the ball in Sony history, if not
is. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, it's about everything.
Like, the Virtual Boy for Nintendo.
And I'm sorry to bring this up during my Final Fantasy VI cast, but since I feel that this will be downloaded probably the most out of the entire thing, I think so anyway. The last time that we got to this, it was the most downloaded of our Final Fantasy
because
Legacy.
Because 6 is a fucking vamp! Because
6
is one of the
people need to know that Sony dropped the fucking ball. Do not buy a fucking Go.
Totally buy
unless
a Go.
Unless you hack it.
Buy it!
Yeah.
In fact, yes, buy a Go and hack the shit out of it. Take it with you.
I'm not a firm believer in hacking my shit.
I'm not either.
That got hacked.
That got hacked.
I'm not a firm believer in hacking my shit, but I took an axe to the toilet.
What the fuck else was I going to do with the damn thing?
No.
They never supported it.
No. No, they didn't do shit with it.
You know, it doesn't even handle, like, the PSP. Actually, this is real. It plays more games than the fucking Go. Because the Go, unless it's digital on their fucking marketplace.
Can't play it.
Can't play it.
Because it's all digital.
Yep.
There is no place for a UMD disc
so
because there's no UMD drive.
As they continually release games, even today for the PSP, they're not being added to the marketplace. So if you were one of the sad motherfuckers, myself included, that bought the fucking Go,
I'm with you on that one. I just can't find mine. But I got my Vita, and that's superior.
Sony was like,
in every
open
way.
Butthole, insert penis. Welcome to the Go.
Surprise butt six.
It was a surprise, all right.
I liked how they released the Vita.
Oh, the Vita's sweet.
They said, this is unhackable.
20 that minutes later. Dumb.
3 days later. Hacks everywhere.
You knew that was coming because they never should have said something like that.
Yeah.
Everybody said, challenge accepted.
Right.
They're like, Really, Sony? How about you bend over, spread them cheeks, and just say, I'm ready.
Now, I had the opportunity, but since the Vita is supported and has been a good system, I support it.
And there's actually a lot of really good games for it. Games that are coming like out soon.
Persona 4 the Golden.
Which is an awesome game. Conversion of that game.
Actually, I've heard that there's a possibility that for the next Golden Week, this is all stipulation, it's rumor, but we actually could see, because they're talking that Part 5 is supposed to somehow take Part 3 and 4 and make them, like...
No, that's the 3DS game. Part 5 is going to be a different story.
Yeah, Persona's got other games coming out.
Right, I realize that, but the Persona, they're trying to link the lineage of these two games, and Part 5 is supposed to somehow solidify the storyline that was happening in Part 3... did somehow create the storyline that was happening in Part 4.
Well, I mean, for, it has to for do God's with sakes,
the Midnight Hour.
And they can, in Part 4, they actually go to the place.
Yeah, they go back to Gekugan High.
They go back to the school, but they never deal with the Midnight Hour.
No, they just go to the school for a class field trip, which was sweet to see the school from the third game in the fourth game.
I think what they're going to show us, and I can't prove this, but I think that the Midnight Hour is taking place in Part 4, but they're always inside.
And they're always looking at the TV.
Watching TV, and that fog, even if they looked outside, they wouldn't find anything.
It's a possibility.
Because in 3, when the Midnight Hour was going on, everyone was in a coffin. Except for Persona users. They were the only ones that are awake and realizing what was going on around them.
And you'll notice that
the ones that were not safe.
Well, it's never spoken out loud. But if you really pay attention, there's not one single person in the game that ever talks to you during that moment, except for people that will later interact with the TV world.
Right.
The very first indication is you never hear from Dojima, even though he's home. When you first fall and bash your face on the coffee table and shit, the little girl comes to check on you.
Naoto.
She will later...
Nanako.
Yeah.
You know what I mean.
She will later go into the TV.
Yeah.
She has the potential to be...
A Persona user. Correct.
Dojima doesn't check on you.
Well, Nanako can't use Persona.
I really feel like that. I really feel like we should get into a Persona talk sometime. That'd be awesome. It's not a legacy.
Actually, no, it is a legacy.
Actually, though...
There are multiple games.
What if we just put the Shin Megami Tensei?
Oh, Jesus Christ, we'd be here for
now,
forever.
Now, hold on. We've went off track, but... We can't go into story too deep. We need to be real careful here and really... Really be careful what we hit on.
Well,
like,
I've got two words for storyline.
What?
Play it.
That's literally two words. That's not what I was going for. One of the parts I did like in the game was general.
Yeah, each person named
General Leo.
General Leo.
Each person here named two parts from the game that you really enjoyed storyline wise, and we'll try not to get too into it because we got to wind this episode down. But go ahead. You like the General Leo?
I'll agree.
When you got to use General Leo to fight Kefka.
Well, you just did it.
But man, that part was cool because they were talking about how awesome General Leo was and how strong
he was.
And
he actually was very
interesting. That motherfucker used a move that would be later used by another great general. Beatrix in 9.
He
uses the shock attack that Leo uses.
The thing that makes Leo most interesting is that he is your enemy and yet you still feel... a true loss.
Well, when he he's your enemy, but he becomes an ally right before he dies.
Because he realized what Kefka did.
But yeah.
Because the enemy of my enemy is
my friend.
No, if you want to get severely technical, he was loyal to a fault. He was not ever your friend. Because this still goes into what I said. There's a lot of philosophy in this game, and... he has dedicated his life to the service of his country and his emperor. So had the emperor fucking told him, this is the way it's going to be, you're there to distract them, he would have did it. He would have did it without question, even though it is not in his personality to be that person. It is not... He is not a bad person. He is still on the other side of the war. He is your enemy, no matter how you feel for him. Had the tables turned one way or another, he would have killed you.
Actually, yeah, that would have been game over.
Yeah, General Lee would have kicked
Sabin
your ass.
Even Sabin would not have been able to go, bing!
No, no.
He would have binged.
He would have binged.
He would have tried to bing, and he'd be like, oh, really? Really? You're going to bing? Shock.
I'm sorry.
Dead.
I'm sorry. Sabin will beat that Leo ass. I'm sorry. I like Leo, but no. There's nothing... If the final attack of the game, if the fucking solar flare move, which only Kefka can use, if he blocks that...
He can block shock.
Fucking shock.
Yeah.
And my second favorite part of the game would probably have to be the Opera House. I really enjoyed that.
Opera House was a lot of fun.
Yes, because you actually get to participate
in the play
in
was,
the
yep.
opera.
And if you don't choose the correct option fast enough, then you fuck up the play.
I realize that. I know that, because I did
if
that.
If you actually do it all perfectly, you get a special item.
I didn't get a special item. I messed up.
It's awesome. It's one of the... Like the first
it's an iconic scene.
Oh, and the music that was going with it, they actually... Nobumatsu actually added in the... kind of a chiptune for a voice, just like they did with the Kefka laugh.
Yep.
Yeah. They did it for Celeste when she was playing as Maria, and what was his name? Draco was the other character for the opera.
Yep.
Yeah. They actually did, like, opera voices, and it was fucking amazing. I think that's probably... The opera song is probably my favorite song out of six.
So that's your two. Where are you at? You can pick one if you want, also, I mean.
Let's see.
Getting sets of
Kefka outside of the castle.
Kefka outside of the castle?
I'm sorry.
At the start?
At the
There's
start,
sand
yes.
on my boots! Oh! Let us take care of that, sir! All done, sir. It's like, ha ha ha, you stupid idiots!
In a desert. Prick.
Yeah.
You're gonna get
but it's Kefka.
I know.
You don't say nothing to Kefka. Because Kefka will not only barbecue you alive, he will poison your entire country's water supply.
I'll get
to,
when
fuck
you got
you.
That may that's what made Kefka unique.
That,
but
that
I'll
was
say Kefka, it when I'm
like,
done.
That's the point when you realize
Joker.
Yeah, that's the point when you realize just how
no,
like
he's
nuts
Kefka.
He's gonna be.
He's
yeah.
basically the Joker.
It comes down to more philosophy. Look it
yes.
up.
Yes.
I'm just saying, like...
Well, the reason why...
For people who have not played the game...
right.
The best way to describe Kefka, he's the Joker.
What made Kefka...
He is the killer psychotic clown.
Is that he was only human until, you know...
Until later.
Until later.
Became a god.
But when he started, he was only a man.
Yeah.
That everybody feared.
He was also a highly psychotic man infused with magic.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean...
That's why he was psychotic.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean...
Celeste
yeah.
was able to bond with it properly.
And because Tara
Kefka went insane.
Tina, Tara can use it because she's half Esper, yes.
Yep.
Yep.
So, there's Kefka in the desert.
And then the other one
like
was the fact that after you beat the game, if you stop to think about it, Kefka was a god.
Yep, you,
you are strong enough to kill a god.
Yeah.
Nobody else in all of Final Fantasy is strong enough to kill a god.
Because nobody else in Final Fantasy became
a god.
No,
that's not true. Final Fantasy 1, four warriors alike killed the god of chaos.
Chaos is a god.
Chaos
okay,
is a
true.
God.
I'll give you that.
Final
Other
Fantasy,
than that.
Final Fantasy 2.
The Emperor became a
the
god.
The Emperor became a highly demonic creature that was deity status.
Wait, he did?
Killed him. Yeah, Final Form Emperor is a deity.
I thought
Cloud of Darkness,
correctly,
three,
though.
The four orphans kill the Cloud of Darkness,
which
the
was
embodiment
technically...
of darkness itself.
But in
Final Fantasy VI, embodiment, or Final Fantasy IV, embodiment of all hatred of humanity.
But not a god.
Not
it
a god.
Deity
no.
status.
No. Not a god. It was not a god.
It was deity
it's
status.
Still, it's still not the same thing. You're still no. talking, you're comparing demigod to godhood. Kefka quite literally shaped reality
well, so
to be
chaos.
What he wanted it to.
Yeah.
Kefka,
so,
which I forgot, chaos
is a god.
Yeah.
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 Which I forgot
opinion,
chaos, so that
in
one
my
I apologize.
Opinion, Kefka would kick chaos's ass.
No, because chaos would reshape all of reality. And, make
and then he would reshape
mortal.
It back. No. They'd be like, reshaping!
Reshaping!
And they both would be doing this.
Actually, the only reason why Kefka's allowed to do all the shit that he is because he's harnessing the power and using that of Chaos. Chaos is like, I'll let it happen, whatever.
He's, no, see, that's just it. He's outside of that system. He made himself. Like, he saw that there were beings of power.
Wanted it.
He pushed a goddamn statue. That's what he did. He was like, psh.
Before that, he was already...
His plan was moving.
Yeah. The Espers control the elemental powers of the universe.
He was killing them.
All of it. And
turning them into
upon
magicites.
Their death...
They turn into magicites.
He doesn't just take magicite. When he kills one, when you kill him, you don't get no magicite for it. He doesn't drop rocks on the ground or nothing like that. No. Because he takes the very soul, the very essence of everything they were into himself. If Bahamut attacks, which Bahamut attacks him.
Yeah, Bahamut.
And he just simply points his finger and the thing fucking dies, turns into a stone, and when he takes it in his hand, he doesn't put it in his pocket.
No.
He crushes the motherfucker and takes the essence of everything he was.
And
he is Bahamut and Kefka. And fucking... And like
Ifrit. And Maduin.
And Madua.
And
like,
Raya.
And Unicorn.
Ramua.
And Kajat. And fucking Kieran.
At the end of the game,
Bismarck,
at the end of the game, those statues, you gotta listen. At the end of the game, the statues don't even exist.
Not anymore, no. The statues were there to
think about that.
Keep the balance of all magic.
They are magic. When you do that, the end of the game, Tina
actually
dies.
No, the statues do show back up.
Tina dies. The end of the game specifically states you have two choices. Come with us to die, or if you're lucky, your human side might let you reside here. Might.
Yep.
They never give you a promise that that character actually lived, because every single Esper, because you destroyed the statues, are dead. They all die. And if you look at the game, even after the destruction of the statues... Kefka was not absorbing magicite power. Your power was draining. He was still a self-made god. He would have continued in that world with all of his power. And if you wouldn't have killed him fast enough, you'd have had none.
All right.
You destroyed
all
magic.
Oh, I would have had some because I had some.
That was number two,
he was
right?
Going to suplex that ass.
All right, Bill.
End of the world. The pushing of the statues to realign the planet into his own image. Reshape the cosmos in his own madness. However...
That's why Kefka is the only Class 3 villain.
There's...
Yeah.
See? That goes back into the philosophy of the game, though. He's not crazy.
He knows exactly what he's doing.
Yeah.
That's the problem. He knows exactly what... He's not insane. He's not out of his mind. He's not crazy. He's not suffering from
acting
madness.
Acting like a... Because
he's not
a,
even... Listen here.
He's
not...
He's a sociopath.
Listen. No, he's not.
No.
He's not even homicidal. He's suffering from a mass form of narcissism. He believes... Truly and honestly believes... At the end of the game, he tells you word for word, there is no point to any of us even existing. And you say, what about love? What about this? What about that? And he says, what about dying? What about your life being torn apart? What about sadness? What about the crippling effects of the world? What about no matter how happy you get, no matter how much you amass in this lifetime, it's all going to be taken away from you. Give up. Let me take it from you now. Let me cast all of us into an oblivion where we live in peace. Let me take all of this away. And give us freedom.
That's not...
It's narcissism. It's different. Look it up. It's different. It is not the same thing as madness.
Well, Square has even come out and said...
He
has been driven insane by being infused with the magic.
They say that in the game when he's still a man. After he absorbs the knowledge of the gods...
Well, after that, yeah. But in the beginning, he is psychotic.
But when he absorbs the knowledge of the gods... He realizes just how futile all of it really is.
At that point, yes.
You can still be.
But at the beginning of the game, he is one fucked up individual.
But it's just like moving. It's just like characters evolve. Where he starts is not, he's not
also,
mad.
Now we know how to treat insanity. Just go kill some espers, absorb their power, you're good. It will treat all mental illness. Right.
Except narcissism, which is actually a mental illness.
You're going to get fucked.
You want a good read? There is a book on the philosophy of Final Fantasy which breaks down every philosophical concept of every game all the way through 13. Every chapter focuses on a different game, completely breaking it down at a philosophical level.
So how big is the chapter on 6? Is it about
Final Fantasy 6? No, every single, like, this book is broken into volumes. Like,
you said every chapter.
Yeah.
So that's why I figured
you get,
it was just
like,
one book.
The first book is Final Fantasy 1.
Oh. We'll have to go hunt these books.
It's just a giant philosophical debate of every single concept throughout every game, and they explain to you. These are straight quotes from the people that designed the character. Kefka is not crazy. He's suffering from the knowledge of gods. This is knowledge you and me, we can't even fathom what he understands. For all we
know... Which would drive us insane.
It's pretty much like somebody
showing up, slapping you in the face, and when they slap you in the face, you understand the meaning of life.
What the
fuck?
Slap me again. Maybe I'll understand quantum physics.
But regardless of if he's insane or not insane, he still knows what he's doing.
And that's just it. An insane person doesn't.
Yeah.
An
insane person would pick up this can and smack you in the face.
With all the stuff
and
that
then
he
cry.
Does throughout the entire game, he's the only Class 3 villain out of all Final Fantasy.
Right. He actually became a god.
Also, if y'all missed this, because I'm pretty sure I said this in the old podcast, there are three Class 3 villains in all types of stuff. You got your Class 1 villain.
That's it.
They get their butts raped pretty
Final
much
Fantasy
at the very
philosophy,
beginning.
Final Fantasy, the ultimate walkthrough.
Cool, how much is it?
And
all
Amazon,
your money.
On Amazon, you can get it for $13.63.
Throw money at someone.
Plus shipping, because it's only free shipping if your order is over
$35. I think there's another set of books also.
I was about to say,
considering the fact knowing Nick, he's going to get multiple books,
he might
get the free shipping.
Years ago, there was there used to be, when Final Fantasy XI was at its peak, there was a group of podcasters which called themselves Limit Break Radio. They introduced me to the book series. They're the ones that first mentioned it, and that's when I started being like, what?
It's only been out for almost 5 years, so it's not even a super old book.
That would explain why I didn't really know anything about it.
I didn't know...
Being married at the time.
I didn't know shit.
Thank God that's over and done with.
That's what I'm getting at. The game... And it's not just this one. Every Final Fantasy can be broke down like this, but... This
Six
game
is a little more complicated.
Is so extreme, and the fact that I always was like, he's crazy as a motherfucker. But like after reading some of it, it really hit me that if he was honestly crazy, he could not have even begun to fathom what he was doing. He was just doing shit, but he wasn't doing shit. Everything he did was calculated.
And planned.
And planned meticulously.
He planned on poisoning the water supply. He planned the invasion of Figaro Castle.
He's not the Joker. He's not a dog chasing a car. If he got it, he wouldn't know what to do with it.
He's
moving towards a goal. He knows exactly
what
he's doing.
Well, you're talking Dark Knight Joker.
Regardless, he's moving towards a goal. He's not crazy. Every rendition of the Joker, except when you tone him down for a Saturday morning cartoon, is madness.
He is insane.
There's even times in the comic book where he has the chance to kill Batman, but then he forgets what he's doing.
He's fucking insane.
There's one point in the 80s when fucking Batman makes a mistake and walks into this building not watching, and the Joker fucking beats him over the head with a fucking crowbar like 5 times.
Oh, you mean the way that he killed Robin?
No. When Batman hits the ground, he stands over him and he lifts the crowbar, and then he like looks around the room and he drops the crowbar and he goes over and has a drink, and then he just leaves. He forgot what he was
doing. Madness.
Madness. There's no actual thought process. It's just do
and
stuff.
I think the reason why a lot of people think he's insane is because Kefka looks like a clown.
Right.
Well,
yeah.
He gives off he's that image.
He gives off that he gives off.
Right.
Which is probably that's probably the reason why people think he's insane is they. You know, he did what Nick did.
He's probably,
they compared him to Joker, and they're like, Joker's fucking insane.
Which is the easiest way to do it. I wouldn't say anything
wrong. Look at all the stuff
about
that he does.
Right?
Until
he becomes a god, he literally looks like a crazy man.
Well, because the things he was doing
was
insane.
And then when he finally becomes a god, he's like, and clarity!
And clarity!
Yeah, legitimately, the only two times I can think of where Joker, like, you almost couldn't tell he was insane was in the Batman Beyond movie, but that's because it's technically not Joker, it's just his mind imprinted on a microchip. And then in the Arkham series, in the first, was it in Arkham Asylum?
Yeah.
He's moving toward getting up the Titan and becoming one of them psycho fucks.
Joker's weird. In a lot of different continuities, he seems like he always has this major goal, but he doesn't actually know what the major outcome. Like, his basic drive is
just
kill people.
Yeah.
His ultimate goal?
Chaos.
For Batman to kill him, if you actually think about that.
Yeah. That's part of what makes
Batman
him.
To kill him.
Later on, like at the start, he's just looking to kill people. However he can do it, why ever he can do it. Then, later on, his character evolves to a point where
he wants to turn Batman into the thing that he is.
Which, he's still out of his fucking mind, but he gives his fucking lunacy a focus. He says, if he killed me, what would happen? Would he be me? Would I become him? He doesn't know. He doesn't even understand the concept of why he wants it so bad. He's just like,
I'm gonna fuck with this guy.
He's gonna kill me. One way or another, he's gonna have no choice. He's gonna kill me. So now, he's always been incredibly intelligent. Now he uses it to formulate these big schemes, but the schemes have no actual purpose. He's not actually looking to take over the city or ransom or get something. It has no benefit to him. He wants to be dead, but he wants to be dead because of Batman.
Yep. He wants to bat.
And then
he wants
later, when they really threw a curveball at you in the Arkham City game, when he basically killed himself, that was part of his disappointment. Batman didn't kill him. He offed himself, and he couldn't fucking handle that.
Well, it was. I still think it was funny that he poisoned Batman with his own blood in Arkham City. He's like, by the way, we both have 12 hours to live.
In one rendition, when he figures out that he can't beat the Batman, he became Batman. And he did the job better than Batman could. But then slowly, throughout the course of like a couple months, he lost his fucking mind again, and he forgot what he was doing, and then he started basically killing people in the Batman suit. Like, Batman was getting all this credit for stopping villains and shit, and he was like, I wasn't there last night.
I was actually at a party.
Yeah.
He's like, I was getting drunk and banging bitches.
Because the Joker was doing his job for him.
But I've been in the hospital for the last 12 months.
The reason why Kefka and Joker... And, the only reason why they pair him is because they look like clowns.
They do, and you can even see those awesome pictures where they take, like, Heath Ledger and they dress him up through Photoshop to look like the Joker. To look like the Joker.
He was the Joker!
Well, I kind of had to Photoshop him now.
It was brilliant!
He's not dead. It's actually just a
Heath
scheme.
Ledger is dead.
It's a scheme. He's not dead. Show me the body.
He was defeated.
By himself.
You get two moments.
What was your
second
one?
If you can find two more moments, I told you.
I know the end of the world.
I love the mid part because when he destroys the world, he really seems psychotic. But I love the clarity you get at the end of the game
when
he tells you that he is not crazy. He just understands this world in a way that you can't possibly fathom.
Oh, man, we already took some good ones, man. You're left with what?
Shadows, flashbacks.
Yes, I was hoping he'd say that. If you use Shadow in the game,
you sleep at the end multiple times.
You'll get flashbacks.
You'll get four flashbacks.
Nightmares of, like, his past.
Yeah.
And remember what I told you? It was one of the few times I told Nick something that he had to be like, what? And he had to go see it. for himself to relive it, to see what I was talking about.
And then when I saw it, I was like, Dubois!
Dubois!
He's somebody's father in that game.
Yeah.
For the characters you get. He's a daddy.
Yeah. Can you guess whose dad he is?
Give me a second.
You only get one kid. It's Realm.
Mm-hmm.
The artist, Realm, the one being taken care of by Strago?
Her dad. Well, Strago's her grandpa.
Right.
So, irony right there, you get an entire three-generation family to go...
Daddies!
Yeah,
you know who gives it away? But when I was a kid, I never realized it.
Shadow?
The dog remembers Realm. And Shadow... Being the guy that would fucking kick his own mom in the fucking titty just for a nickel. He went out of his way to risk his life to save the little girl.
Yep.
This is
during the burning house event.
Because that's his daughter.
Because that's his daughter.
Do they ever
do anything but show flashbacks that give you a vague impression of what's going on. But if you put it together, that's his kid.
I mean... I figured you could have just told me how it ended, just like I didn't know Tina died because I didn't beat the game. Thank you. I look forward to that.
Don't worry. We'll set,
anyway.
We'll set Nick down a nickel speedrun it for
you. But like I said, they won't show it to you.
Not six, I can't really speedrun that.
Six
long.
Is long.
Four, I can speedrun in 15 hours by fighting every boss.
Which
12
he's proved.
If I don't.
He's proved that.
I hit 15 hours exactly when I.
But that's because four is
after
your
you,
final
after
fantasy.
You increase the timer. I can do this in 12.
I could. No. I could do it in 12 if I didn't fight every boss.
Yeah, I know.
I went out of my way to fight every boss, so it took me an extra 3 hours.
Which is the reason why you had to increase
that's
the time.
That, and I did get lost in the lunar.
I'm gonna beat every boss, but I'm gonna need an extra 3 hours. I'll get it. Just 3 hours, and I promise I'll have it.
But he did do it.
That's sick.
Every fucking boss in that game. Yeah. I'm gonna tell you something. Asura can suck my fucking nuts.
And that
because fuck that bitch.
She probably would.
What's the next guy?
But anyway.
The other moment, when Terra uses her magic the first time in battle, when you have Locke and Edgar in your party, finally, the first battle, I even did it on the Android version, and it still made me laugh my ass off.
You know what's funny?
Because it's like, she throws fire, and then all out of nowhere, they just leap forward. And Edgar's like, oh my god, did you see that? That was magic!
You can cause the game to freak out if you wait. This is tough to do. Wait until you get to Ultros, then finally use magic.
Ultros is one of those unique bosses.
And
he makes me laugh.
Like, because the characters, the way the scene is, they'll like jump off into the water to talk.
Oh, yeah. I remember seeing that once. I'm like, what are you
because
doing?
Because the
like,
raft is only
in?
So big. Yeah. And they go down to the bottom of the screen to talk. So when you do it,
actually,
they'll be
I
like,
one more
whoa!
Moment.
And he'll jump off into the water
I've
to talk
about
I've
got one more
magic.
Moment. And it's all the Ultros battles.
Ultros was awesome.
Well, especially the last time you fight Ultros, Realm's in your party. And she'll paint a picture of him. And then he'll beat the fuck out of himself and kill himself.
And then he has this weird fit of realism where he figures out he's nothing but a fucking octopus.
Yep.
And it like breaks his fucking soul. Later on you find him like, quote unquote, working for the man, like doing your Mick jobs and shit. Like he'll start showing up in stores and shit like, yeah, here's some items. I don't give a fuck.
I'm an octopus.
I still love it when he's working in the arena. Who do you want to fight?
Yeah, like, he's
well,
like,
well and the best part is
shit.
Mr. Chupin shows up, and you're like, the fuck is this bullshit? Because it's like,
God.
You start the fight, you might get one shot. You'd be like, bing! Do a little bit of damage, and then he's like, sneeze.
Ultros,
you lose.
Faggot.
Did not realize he was an octopus.
He bites you like five times before he figures it out.
Yeah. He's not. He doesn't think he's an octopus.
He even says weird stuff too, like when you very first fucking hit him with fire, he says like, "Ooh, fish stew" or some shit like that, and I'm like, how do you not
know what you are? Like, eight-armed motherfucker.
He even does weird shit like he writes a ransom letter. How did he do that shit?
Well, no, he's a unique...
No.
He's
you know
a
who
unique,
he uses you know who own ink?
You know who Ultros is?
Octodad?
Octodad.
Yeah. It's true. He's the blue version of Octodad.
But I tell you...
That game is fucking hilarious.
With those three choices you've picked, and you've got your two, my two, Seth's two. This has been a long podcast.
Actually, there's one more.
What?
Oh, you have a lot, man.
Sabin suplexing a motherfucking train.
Yeah, he does suplex a train.
He also holds a house up. So
for 7 fucking days, he's like, Jesus Christ, somebody get these people out of here. I'm hungry.
Starting to
somebody
get tired.
Somebody bring me a cheeseburger.
When you find him, you're like, you're alive? And he's like, little thing like the end of the world wasn't going to put me down.
I believe it.
Yeah. You broke ass motherfucker.
Yeah, he's just holding the house. Do you really think the end of the world is going to stop me?
It's like, he's been there for a week acting as a pillar. Like, yeah.
It's like, don't worry.
So let me ask you a question.
Was that house
on fire for a week?
It's like, we don't know what to do.
It's weird how they even say that, too. They're like, oh, he's... I think it's a mistranslation. I think he was supposed to be there for... Like a couple hours or something. Because it's weird to believe that, like, the house was all burning and shit, and he was like, oh.
Did you not see how big that fucking house was?
But for a week? Like, you got into the house. You got to run around in the house.
Like, yeah, but...
The size of 12 parks.
For him to be like, I'm holding this up, somebody should probably go save that little kid. And everybody in the town was like,
nah.
I don't know, it's on fire. Yeah, it's kind of on fire.
And in 1 week, I'm pretty sure somebody will come.
And the motherfucker didn't burn down in 1 whole week. He was just like...
Because...
What's he doing? He's like...
No.
Keeping the fire at
bay, too? Bill, he was combating the fire with his fire dance.
Let me dance. What was he, wiggling his hips? Fire dance!
He was doing the Irish into the house.
I'm telling you right now.
Let me hold on.
But
damn you.
I know we gotta rate it. So I'm gonna rate mine.
5.
Correct. Yeah, 5.
Period.
Wow.
5.
All right.
Because, honestly, I'm not gonna give it a 5.
Oh.
I'm giving it a 10. You wanna know why I can give it a 10? Because Sabin is broke as a fucking joke, and he just broke our score.
All right, guess what?
It's a 7.5 because Sabin's broke as a joke.
The reason I give this a perfect score is because...
It's a perfect game.
Like, okay, I like 4, I like 7, but I could put Final Fantasy 6 in now, and I'll beat the game. If I put Final Fantasy 7 in, I might get to the second disc before my nostalgia dies... And I'm going to go find something else to do.
You'll put 13 in?
And never play it.
10 fucking minutes.
13 too.
No, he'll put it in, watch the first scene, and that was nice.
Somebody hold him to that. He admitted to wanting to play it for 10 minutes.
Let's play it for 10 minutes.
All right, I'm going to go put it in.
But really.
Not really.
And actually, after double-checking his move list, Sabin probably could have been fighting off the fire using Airblade.
Oh, yeah, Airblade. That would have done it.
So maybe.
And he could have just kicked
maybe,
the airblade.
Maybe, just maybe.
Yeah, he could have been holding the house for a week.
Too goddamn broken.
But
that's why I said I'm giving the game a score of 10.
But since
because Sabin is so broke, he just broke our scoring meter.
But this now sits at the highest pinnacle of Final Fantasy.
Because it's fucking broke as a joke.
I feel like it is.
Yep, I say
it's a perfect score game. I don't feel like anything about it. It never feels bland.
Yeah.
There's never a part where the story drags for me. There's never a part where it doesn't look right. There's never a part when it doesn't sound good. Everything about it is perfect.
There's only one thing that is slightly stupid that we didn't really touch on that we touched on with last time. And that's the fact that the character sprites on the map do not go with their character portraits. That's a tiny fucking thing. Last time we did it, I know Spencer gave it a whole bunch of shit.
I can't but downgrade a game like that for something so minor.
When you're looking at the map,
the only reason
the time,
I can't drag on that is because there hasn't been a Final Fantasy except till like until Final Fantasy VII. There was never a Final Fantasy that fucking followed their goddamn concept art.
Yeah. Well, that was the problem.
But this, this has been the Final Fantasy VI podcast, and the next episode we're gonna do what people quote unquote call the best Final Fantasy,
which is not
fanboys
right.
Be damned.
Final Fantasy VII's next.